Seeking things which which are material things of this world, seeking food or seeking money, seeking possessions, even those that don't have seem to want more. Mm. But what's rare and what's difficult to find or seem difficult to find is people who really have a heart after God.
Hallelujah.
I find it amazing that Dr. Key travels to 60 plus, nearly 70 countries a year, looking for these people as commissioned by God. You know, God goes to some amazing lengths to find those people, to find people that will have and seek Him for a relationship with Him. But we know God goes to amazing lengths because we know what His Son did for us. He came from heaven, stripped Himself of all dignity and the rightful place. He gave Himself up as a servant for each one of us. That is amazing. Tonight we've been singing some amazing songs about that King and about how He's worth more than gold and more than silver. And He is worth more than gold and silver. And our heart's desire, like you sang tonight, should be for Him and His kingdom. Most of all, God is looking for people who want to know Him. So tonight, my encouragement to you guys is, you know, to listen to what God has got to say. If God is sending someone from thousands of miles away around the world to see you guys, then He must have a pretty special message. You know, God wants to speak something to you tonight that you can keep and that you can work with and that you can develop, so that the songs that you sang tonight can become even more of a reality in your normal lives. God is amazing. So please prepare your heart. If you've got notepads and pens, you know, make some notes about what God is going to say tonight through Dr. Keith. And let's see what God does as you apply these truths to your lives. He's a loving God. He desires a relationship with you guys. See, there's just a few people here tonight. It's not a mega church. There's not 500 seats. But God is interested in big numbers. He's interested in people who love Him and who will follow Him and His heart. So I encourage you tonight to listen to Dr. Keith. Thank you for listening to me. It's great to be with you. It's great to meet you. It's been an adventure going with Dr. Keith. It's a great way to finish in this home tonight. So thank you for welcoming me, and I hand you over to Dr. Keith.
Some of the things I'll say tonight, you may need to look back over and study them again and again, and remind yourself of some key truths that we all need to focus on. We may be in a different situation. I don't know how the church is going here, but it's always important to refocus from time to time and remind yourself what you're doing, why you're doing it, and also focus your eyes on Jesus. The trouble is, after a while you start focusing on the wrong things and your eyes start to drift, and now you're no longer looking unto Christ. You start to look at yourself, or maybe you start to look at others. Maybe you start to look at your situation. Maybe you start to look at different things. But the Bible says, fix your mind and your eyes on Him.
Hallelujah.
And that's something we have to continually remind ourselves to do, especially in the hard times, especially when things are not going well. It's important to be able to do that. When you see a professional and an amateur, both of them can do those tricks and those clever things like balancing the ball and throwing it up in the air and juggling it or whatever. I mean, they can all do those tricks. But for one who's a professional, he can do his basics. He can do his basics better than the amateur. Even under pressure, he will still win. And he will still have a good time, and he will play well even if the whole team doesn't play well. He will have the ability to do his part. And I don't know about you, but you're a player too. Can you do your basics? Can you live the kind of relationship with God that we're hopefully talking about tonight, and develop that to the more and more? Jesus is coming back, is that right?
Amen.
So we've got to be focused. We can't be thinking about what others are doing. And you may look at me and you say, well, this man travels 70 nations a year. I would really like to be like him. Forget it. God could just suddenly say, stay at home for me, and I'd be happy with that. I know who I serve. It is not some ministry schedule. I'm not trying to prove to somebody else that I'm a man of God. I know that Jesus is coming soon. Amen. And we need to be focused on that. I want to try and describe to you tonight one of the most important basics that you need to have as a child of God. And it's no surprise to you, it's the love of God. We know that the love of God defines us. We can't go around in this world and share and tell people God loves you, and then you turn around and you lack that same love. It's like looking at a starving child who is saying, my father owns all the grocery stores in all of Dubai or all of Abu Dhabi. You're not going to believe that child. That child is starving. And we, as children of God, should have a close relationship with Him where we're fully satisfied with the love of God. In fact, we should have some to export. So anytime you meet somebody slightly deficient in the love of God, instead of you maybe trying to get some life from somebody else, you've got something to give. You don't get down because you've got plenty in supply. You should be connected to the source. We know from the Bible that God is love. Yes? That is the source. Maybe you can get a few snacks from somebody else today, and they can come along and help you in your walk with God. I can maybe help you a little bit, but my real help is to try and get you to go to the source and get your supply yourself. You need to know God is love. It can't be in your head. It's got to be in your heart. See, there's a big difference between your head and your heart. And the Bible says that even the devils believe that Jesus is Lord, but they go to hell. So just believing with your head won't save you. You've got to believe with your heart. And from time to time, you know, when we're teaching, I have to get people to write down, I give them a question, I say, now you write down the answer to this question. And what they put down on that piece of paper is what they believe in their heart, and they're shocked. They realize, I don't believe the truth. Because you've got to believe with your heart. God is love. Amen?
Amen.
And yet, we as His children need to access that love. Jesus, for example, was the Father manifested in the flesh. You know that. He had that ability to love. And we're certainly, all of us here, are charged and double charged with the mandate to be like Him. You may say, well, what's my calling? You may say, I don't know my calling. I'll tell you your calling. Your calling is to be like Him. You are to reach the fullness and the measure and the stature of Christ. So you're supposed to be like Him. You're supposed to have the same kind of love that He had. He was connected to the Father. He manifested the Father's love. And the Bible says because of that, many people came after Him. He was very popular at the beginning. You know Jesus' ministry. He started with about 5,000 people following Him. And they all came to Him. They loved Him because He wasn't like the other ministries that were around at that time. The other ministries were only interested in ministry. They were interested in church. They were interested in business. Have you lost your focus? I'm not picking on you, but I'm just saying, try to think about it. This is a message for you. You've got to examine yourself. Is He your first love? If you're not careful, you find out that you came tonight, well, I'll just go along. I'll just turn up. You know, you didn't really come with a love and a joy and a peace. You didn't really come with that right motivation. You understand? You've got to be careful. I mean, there's no point in you coming if you don't come and do things out of love. We'll look at that later on, but the love of God is the most important thing, yes? Now, as I say, all the people were coming after Jesus because of that love. That's what drew them to Jesus. But the religious leaders, the ones who, think about this now, The religious leaders, they were jealous of Jesus. They didn't like the fact that everybody went after him. Now, I don't know if you've ever had a jealousy spirit about anybody else. Have you ever had that problem? Maybe you haven't. Maybe you're holy and mighty and wonderful and perfect. I don't know, but you should never be jealous of anyone else. If you have that love relationship, you're becoming religious. If you have that jealousy spirit, that's a Pharisee spirit. Yeah, you understand? That's a Sadducee spirit. It makes you sad, makes you look sad. Anyway, that's another thing. So be careful. And the religious leaders, they were trying to stop Jesus. And they tried to trick him. And here in Matthew 22, in verse 34, this is what he said. This is what the scripture says, Matthew 22, starting in verse 34.
When he saw that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they came together, and one of them, a teacher of the law, tried to trap him with a question. Teacher, he asked, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and the most important commandment. The second most important commandment is like this. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. The whole law of God.
And you also got to be.
And here is an amazing account of Jesus' situation. These were religious people. They're trying to trap him. And they asked him a very clever question. They said, Master, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Now, I don't know if you understand how tricky that question is, bearing in mind that there were literally thousands of laws at that time, and any one of them is just a loophole. You know, they created laws just to trick, just to have every kind of regulation for every little thing that was to be done. And this man asked Jesus a very clever question. He said, which is the greatest one? And if that was me, I'd probably say, give me a month, give me a week, let me get back to you, let me study my Bible, and I'll give you an answer next week or next month. It's a dangerous question. But Jesus didn't even hesitate. He was cool under pressure. Some people aren't cool under pressure. When you're under pressure, you panic. But Jesus, he answered instantly, knowing that these people were trying to trick him. And he answered very cleverly. He said, the greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your mind. And Luke says, even your strength. Then he says, and the second is like unto it. Notice he didn't ask him for the second one, but he gave it to them because they weren't doing that. The second one was to love your neighbor as your very own self. They weren't loving Jesus. They're trying to trick him. Then he says the most amazing statement, and this is good news for you and me. He said, on these two commands hang all the law and all the prophets. And that's good news. I don't want you to be religious. We're not here to keep the law. We're not supposed to be under the law. We're supposed to be under the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the only one we're supposed to be serving. And if you're trying to keep the law and make sure you don't sin against God, it's easy. It's not complicated, just love God. I don't know if you can see this. It's not rocket science. Some of you are having a problem with sin because you don't love God enough. Some of you are having a problem with sin because you haven't been developing your love relationship with God. You can't sin and love God and say you can. It's impossible. Don't make this complicated. Don't make Christianity complicated. Don't make your system rules or regulations. The love of God is the most important thing. And sure enough, Jesus said these words. He said, to love God and love your neighbor is the fulfillment of the law. And if I asked the question today, and I said, how many of you here love God? Anybody love God? Amen. Okay. How about loving your neighbor? Is that good too?
Yeah.
Okay, so not such a wild response on the second one, but anyway, if we love God and we love our neighbor, does that mean then that we have fulfilled the law? Does that mean we've never sinned against God? No. That's not what this is saying. This is saying if we love God with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind, and all our strength. That's a little bit more challenging. This is an amazing statement. And also to love your neighbor as your very own self. So if you can do these two things, I mean, Jesus is coming soon. We've already agreed on that. Well, if he's coming soon then, we need to focus. We can't be dragged away by peripheral teachings that take us away from the priorities. This is a time to focus. It's not a time to get off into other teachings. We need to come back to the basic. Is he the first love? And the first thing we need to develop is this relationship so I can say I love God with all my heart, all my soul, all my mind, even my strength. Okay? Now, I haven't got there yet, so don't look at me like I've made it. I haven't made it. And maybe you realize yourself you've been behind on this. You haven't been developing this love. You've been developing other things, but not this love. Love is the most powerful force on the face of the earth. Do you believe that? I can share testimony of what the love of God can do. The Bible says love is the greatest. It looks at love, faith, and hope. But love is the greatest. You know, you're having trouble trying to do something out of faith. You don't realize. You need the love. That's what your problem is.
Hallelujah.
You got the faith working, you haven't got the love working. So you need to develop your love. Love will do things that faith can't do. Now, here, let's examine ourselves. Maybe, let's say for the sake of illustration, maybe you're at 60%. You're not at 100%. I don't know if you do this, but within our ministry, we have an accountability system. If you're working for me or and the ones above me, I report to them on a weekly basis the condition of my soul. That includes how much time I'm spending in the presence of God, what I'm working on, any sins that I'm trying to overcome. It includes any report about my relationship with my wife, my children, anything going on in my home. That seems ridiculous, but that's what we do because we have oversight. It's not just talk, it's not just some name above you. This is what we call accountability. So you give a report to your senior authority so he can look out for you and say, look, if you're having trouble in this area, then do this. Your authority is there to help you spiritually and get you to move on. He's not there to criticize you, run you down, pull you, destroy you. What he's trying to do is uplift you and love you. You can't do that if you don't do it out of love. But we have that system. So let's say, for the sake of illustration, you assess yourself today in front of me, and we all ask God what percentage we love him. We've gone around the room. Maybe this brother is 60%, maybe this brother is 70, maybe this brother is 50, and we go around the room, we get figures, and God confirms those. Well, none of us are 100%. Even if you look at me and you say, well, I'm 80%, I'm still not at 100. I'm missing the mark, just like you. none of us have arrived 100%. If you're trying to look for a perfect person, you're wasting your time. There is no perfect pastor. There is no perfect ministry. There's only Jesus who's perfect. And sometimes we have to look at Jesus because the ones in front of us are not living the lifestyle, maybe, but we have to focus on Him from time to time. Now, like I say, what do we do then? Because the Bible says that sin is missing the mark. If I'm only at 80% and you're at 70 or 60, and we're trying to aim at the standard, and we're coming way below the standard because the standard's 100%, what are we going to do? Just give up? You think that's what God's saying? I mean, if we give up, sin remains. I mean, if missing the mark is sin, then I've already missed the mark. So have you. But what about if the fact that I can take advantage of one aspect of God that will help me? And you should know this. God sees things in fullness.
Hallelujah.
He sees the end from the beginning. He can look at your heart. He can look at these children here. He can look at any of us and see where we are now. Look at what you are focusing on. That's why it's important to fix your mind on Him. If you're fixing your mind on other things, He can look at where you are and what you're trying to aim at. And because He sees the end from the beginning, it's as if, God says, as if you've already arrived, but you haven't arrived. You understand? In this temporal life which we live in now, which is fast disappearing, we know that God can look at things and see things in fullness. He can see the end from the beginning. So suddenly I'm hitting 100%. But the moment I make excuses, I take my eyes off the standard. Don't try and change the standard. That's what some people do. They try and adjust the Word of God. They try to water it down. They try to bring it down to a human level. But we mustn't do that. We must keep the standard high and aim at the mark. Now, I don't know if this helps you, but if we're trying to aim at the mark, you may say, well, I'm struggling. And many of us have struggled. I certainly have struggled, but I'm still pressing towards the mark. I'm not making excuses. This is important if you're aiming at the mark. When you aim at the mark, you don't make excuses. What you do is you look for reasons why you can't do what God says. You can say you're aiming at the mark, but it's just talk. So you've got to have some key notes where you're examining yourself and you're finding out why you're not where you should be. You're doing that, then you're making good progress. You're aiming at the mark. So, this is all important about getting God's grace flowing in your life. Let's look at how important this love is. Because I don't know if you realize how important it is. It's very rare on this earth, the love of God. 1 Corinthians 13 describes the love of God. Let's have a look at that. Okay, let me read that. Verses 1 to 3.
Christ is the branch of Adam and of Abel, but I am not thou. I am only a resounding bond or a man. If I have the gift of prophecy and can transform all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but I am not thou, I am nothing. If I give all the possessions to the world and surrender my body to the dead, but I am not thou, I am nothing.
Okay. Here is an amazing statement that Paul made. He went to an extreme, but he was talking in the previous chapter about the gifts of the Spirit and their place in the church. A lot of people talk about the ministry of gifts, the Holy Spirit, prophecy, and this is more popular teaching, especially today. I think people like the prophetic ministry. They want to hear something nice, they want to hear something that tickles their ears. But Paul said, the last verse of the 1 Corinthians chapter 12, he said, let me show you a more excellent way. Then he began this great love chapter and started explaining something very important that I think we need to focus on. He said, even if I speak with the tongues of men, angels, and do prophecy, understand all mysteries, or have all knowledge, even if I have the great faith that I can move mountains, but have not love, two results. I am nothing, Paul said, and it will profit me nothing. Now he's not talking about this world. If you have the ability to move a mountain, just take that one thing. If you could go here in somewhere in Abu Dhabi or Dubai or even back in India, and you stood there and you pointed at a mountain, even a small one, and you saw it just lift up in front of you, fly across the skyline and disappear somewhere in the ocean, I think everybody would want to talk to you. I think you'd be a very important person overnight. And there would be TV stations, there would be many people trying to come there and interview you and say, how did you do that? You'd be famous overnight. In fact, if you were in the ministry, you could demand any amount of money. Your show on finance will be after that, because the TV stations come to you, you could say, well, I'm not going to talk to you unless you first pay my consultancy fee. And you can name your price. 100,000, no problem to them. That could be 100,000 pounds, 100,000 dirhams. So you just name your price, dollars, pounds, pence, whatever you've got. And you won't talk to them until they pay the fee. And they will pay for a private interview so that they can know exactly what you were doing, how you moved the mountain, and so on. In this world, if you can do that one thing, you'd be famous. What about add to that, that you have the gift of knowledge, you understood all mysteries, you had the gift of prophecy. You're going to be something. Overnight, you are going to be a success, and anybody wants to talk to you. You couldn't even sleep at night. Then you'd be getting 100 emails, and I don't know why. You just wouldn't. You couldn't go anywhere. You couldn't even go to the bathroom without people knowing about you. So, Paul said, if you could do all those things and have not love, it profits you as you are. Now, that's serious. We need to realize how important this love is. It's in very short supply. The world doesn't have it. You, as a child of God, you're born again. I don't know if you're born again, but if you are, you have access to that love. The world doesn't have access. Let's look at 1 John chapter 4 and verse 19. It says this. It says, we love God because He first loved us. So none of us had this love in the beginning. We weren't born with it. You look at your life before you came to Christ, you were a good person. You knew how to care for children, you knew how to say hello, you knew how to respond nicely, you knew how to behave in a nice way. You understand? But that's not love. This love only came when you experienced the love of God. You came at salvation. You understand? Well, when God loved us, that's what the Bible says. Maybe God put a bit of that love in you because you needed it. I'm not saying that, like women, you take care of children. God gives you a natural affinity for children, a love, a care, a concern there. And He put a little bit of that in you so that you can take care of children. God puts a little bit, I think, in all of us, because otherwise I think this world would be a terrible place. But that soon runs out. If you want to get love, the best way, the only way we can do that is as children of God, is to make sure we're connected to sobriety. If you suspect that you have a love deficiency, I don't know if you want to make a test. Maybe you don't really care. Maybe you just want to go on and ignore this reality. In fact, you, life is about ministry. When I was in ministry before, and I'm saying this as this is my testimony, I was doing some of those things listed there in the Bible. You read in 1 Corinthians 13. I was casting out devils. I was praying for the sick. I did those things. And this is what I said to myself. I know it's terrible, but I'm just telling you the truth. I said to myself, well, God does these things through me. Therefore, my life must be okay. I mean, when you see the power of God moving through your own life, you begin to think everything's okay. But it's not okay. Don't use ministry or your human efforts or your human sacrifice as proof that everything's right in your life. You need to take a test. You need to examine yourself. Now let's look at this. The test, if you want to check yourself, is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Beginning at verse 4 and read right through to verse 8. And I suggest if you were doing this properly, you take each word, and I've done this, and you grade yourself on it. You actually record percentage, how well you do on every single one. And you don't do that because you don't believe in that. But I do. I don't think it's something you can just rush over. We can just rush over it now. But while you're at home, later tonight, or maybe some other time, please go through each word and mark yourself on that out of 100. Okay, go ahead.
1 Corinthians 13:4-8. Love is patient and kind. It does not jealous or conceited or proud. Love is not a matter of jealousy or but they are temporary. There are gifts of speaking in strange tongues, but they will be. There is knowledge, but it will pass.
So here we get an idea of what love can do. You can just mention a few of these things. Love doesn't envy. It's not envious of anyone else. Love is focused. Okay? Love is not puffed up. Knowledge puffs up, but love is not puffed up. Another one is here. I like some of these comments. We'll just read through. It says here, love suffers long. It's kind. It says also, love doesn't behave itself unseemly. Speaks on its own. Rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Bears all things. Believes all things. Hopes all things. Endures all things. You know, love doesn't look for evil. It's looking for good. Then my favorite is verse 8. It says, love never fails. So any time, maybe in the past, you failed, it's probably due to the fact you're not doing it out of love. That's why you failed. So, assess yourself in this area, okay? It's not your lack of faith that's the problem, it's your lack of love. Okay. Now, if you've taken that test, and you suspect in some of those statements there, your love is not functioning properly, and you know that you just have a natural love. You haven't really developed this. Try to see it like this. In the beginning, I just use that cup in the mouth. Here's the cup. Not that one, that cup. In the beginning, we all started with a quantity of love. God gave us that quantity because we were born again into the family of God, and the Holy Spirit came in. And we had, let's say, one glass of love. But the trouble is, because we're ignorant of the truth, We just use that love on ourselves. We're selfish. We're seeking love. Instead of actually learning how to connect and supply, we just kept using the little we had, and suddenly, we run out. It's like, it's a very childish approach. You have a need. Instead of thinking about why that need is there, you just go and consume everything and fill that need, but in the end, you just run out. You just run out of supply. When you have a need, you need to ask the question, why is that need there? Why is the emptiness in my soul? Why am I not hearing the Lord? Why am I not close to Him? Why don't I have that joy? Why don't I have that peace? You need to ask these questions. Because if you don't, you're just going to go on and on and on and eventually wear yourself out. Keep going. Right. So this love is very important. Is there anywhere in the Bible that would tell us why we don't have the kind of love we should have? I mean, is there? Do you know? Can anyone tell me the scripture that tells me very clearly the reason why I can't love? Anybody know the scripture? Sorry? Go ahead. No? Okay, I'll help you out. 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 and 8 tells us very clearly. Maybe in your life, you realize that for whatever reason you come from a Hindu background or you come from some other religious background, and all you see is God as a hard taskmaster. You've grown up with religion. Some of you are wearing coverings. Some of you may come from a religious background. You don't really understand why you do those things. And you just, if you're not careful, you've got the wrong impression of God. You don't understand. See? Well, you may blame that. You may blame the fact that you were hurt or persecuted, or you went through some traumatic experience. And these are all just surface things. As a child of God, like I said, I keep saying it, you have access to God. Don't you read the scripture? In 1 John 4, verses 7 and 8.
Brethren, let us love one another, because love is from God. Whoever loves is a child of God and knows God. Whoever does not love God, does not know God, for God is love.
Okay, so here's a very clear statement of why we can't love. It says, first of all, it says, beloved, let us love one another. Why? Because God is love. We're going to go and share with each other about the love of God. The world will see that. This is not just a natural affinity, this is the love of God. And the Bible says when the world sees our love one for another, what will they do? What will happen if the world sees our love one for another? They will believe. The Bible says they will believe. This is the greatest tool to evangelism. It's not G12 or whatever else system you're trying to use. The greatest tool of evangelism is loving one another with the love of God. Not a natural love, because the world can understand that. But the world can understand that pure agape love. Yes? This is the kind of love that Jesus had when He died on the cross. He gave up His life willingly. He did it, He was focused on the fact that He was dying for you and for me. We were in our sins. We were enemies of God. Why would He focus on you and me and saving us when we haven't even yet decided to follow Him? I mean, if I had already made the decision to follow Him, I could understand why He might be trying to help me. But He didn't. He died for me when I was in my sins. That doesn't make a lot of sense to me. I mean, you know, but He did that. That's the kind of love we need to have. You may die for a good person or a good cause, wouldn't you? You probably might do that. If it required your life, but would you dare to die for an unrighteous man? No. Therefore, you don't have this depth of love that Jesus had. You don't have that pure love. But if you do, then you can die for anyone. You can give up your life for any person, any cause, whatever it says. Here, then, this love, like I say, is very, very rare. He said, beloved, let us love one another. Beloved of God, and everyone that loves, who has this ability that we're talking about, even to die for the unrighteous, he says, they're born of God and they know God. Two things. Then in verse 8, it says it very clearly. It says, he that loves not, you might be trying to love, you're giving all you can, but you can't give any more. You don't have that ability. It gives only one reason. Not 100, not 10. One reason. It says, you don't know God. Now, I know that this might be hitting a little bit on your theology or whatever your understanding, but hear what the Bible is saying. It's good to get a correct diagnosis. People are dying every day in hospitals because they misdiagnose the condition of their soul, the condition of their medical condition, sorry. But the same thing is happening spiritually. People are misdiagnosing the condition that they're in. They blame the pastor, they blame the church, they blame their government, they blame something else. But you never really see the main cause. You and me. I'm talking about that. Children of God who have access to the Holy Spirit. So please meditate a little bit on this. The degree to which you can love is the degree to which you know Him. So if you say to me you know God then and you don't love your brother, then you're lying. You're deceiving yourself. Okay? So we need to make sure that we know Him. In John 10:27, Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me. That's a scripture I've shared with you many times. John 10:27, my sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me. Verse 28 says, I give unto them eternal life. Okay, what's eternal life? Let me tell you, she knows his name. What's eternal life? Anybody tell me? What does the Bible say eternal life is? Hmm? Can you tell me? Okay, you can't tell me. Anyone tell me? Just shout it out. She knows it. What does the Bible say eternal life is? Huh? Oh, my goodness. Tell me, I've been here so many times and you still don't know. No? Anybody? Okay, we're going to go right back to basics. Jesus was praying for you and for me. Many people say eternal life is living forever or so on, but please understand, we are eternal beings. We are trapped in time now. This may confuse your brain a little bit, but this reality we're in now is not real. It's not. This is a short time. One of these days, you're going to be in eternity, and you're going to look back at this event like a puff of smoke. It's going to mean nothing. Do you understand? This period of time, which seems to be taking forever. What happened was, when you came into this world, you were like Jeremiah. God knew you before you were born. You had an existence before you came here, but somehow your memory was wiped. Your brain, which is a very clever piece of equipment, you forgot all that time you had with God in the Spirit. And when you came here, you had no memory, and you agreed that you came here to do God's will. You didn't come here to do your will. You agreed that when you came to this planet, that you didn't even need to understand anything. All you need to do is to trust God. agree that if you learn to do that and obey Him, you'd be fine. But somewhere along the line, after God wiping your memory, you chose to go back to reason and understanding and trust in this way rather than trusting God. But the way to live is to trust in God. So what then is eternal life? It's not living forever. It's not going to heaven. Even the Bible says heaven is going to be destroyed. So heaven is not safe. The Bible says heaven and earth will pass away. There's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. But heaven's not permanent. It's not safe. And the Bible says all those who are in heaven will be given up, will be delivered from heaven and stand before God and the great white throne. I'm not going to be there. You might be, but I'm not going to be. I'm going to be ruling and reigning with Christ. See, some of you are making a mistake. You're aiming at heaven. Now we should be aiming at ruling and reigning with Him. You can't do both. You can't be in heaven and rule and reign with Christ. You've got to be one place or the other. If you're in heaven, you're just sitting there. You're a spectator. You're just watching everything happen. But if you're with Christ, actually going around busy during the millennial reign, you're the one, you hear His voice, you've learned to obey Him, you've learned to trust Him and follow Him, He can use you in His government. But if you don't learn to hear His voice, how can He use you in His government? Do you understand? Don't be heaven-focused. Be Christ-focused. Understand? I know it's a simple mistake, but some of you are so focused on heaven, you're thinking about how what a terrible life you lead, and you're just thinking about getting rid of suffering and getting a better pay packet or something. I don't know what you're looking for. Maybe you think heaven is just a good hotel. I don't know. What are you on? Forget heaven. Heaven is just a place. So what's eternal life then? Jesus defined it in John 17. And let's read it back together. John 17, verse 3. Go ahead.
ഇപ്പോൾ പിതാവ് ലോകം ഉണ്ടായതുകൊണ്ട് മുമ്പേ എനിക്ക് നിന്റെ അടുക്കൽ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്ന മഹത്വത്തിൽ എന്നെ നിന്റെ അടുക്കൽ
മഹത്വപ്പെടുത്താണ് great intercessory prayer to His Father. He's also praying for the disciples who are with Him. So this is a very important prayer. And in verse 3 He says, this is life eternal, that we, you and I, may know Thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom He sent. This is one of the first messages I shared with you, so you must have forgotten it. It's not living forever. It's not going to heaven. It's knowing Him, okay? This is a gift that Jesus gave you. He paid for it on the cross, and He gave it to us the first day of our salvation. The ability, the functionality, the authority to know the Father and the Son in a personal, intimate way. If we don't do that, we don't use that gift, then we're insulting the one who gave us the gift. Don't use it. So, if you don't know how, ask the Holy Spirit. If you want to get this working in your life, you first will have to know what eternal life is. Because if you don't know what eternal life is, how can you get it off the pages into your life? If you believe that eternal life is you just go to heaven or you live forever, then your faith is not in the Word of God. It's in a lie. It's in a half-truth. It won't work like that. It only works when you have your faith in the Bible. So, if you can get this eternal life into you and working, then you can enjoy a greater ability to love. Now, let's define the love of God, please. In John 14:15, The love of God is divine. It's not a natural love. Remember I said that in the beginning. This is the agape love of God. Let's read that out.
You know me. You will obey what I command.
That's right. Jesus here is defining the love of God. It's in practice, he did everything the Father told him to do. I don't know if you've lost your focus. Maybe you come to meetings, maybe you do things, and your focus is, I'll just do it because I have to. You do it maybe because you have a position in the church and you've got to come, or Shino asked you to come, or whatever. But you don't even know why you're here. The reason I go anywhere or do anything is because I love Him. That's got to be the motivation. We read in 1 Corinthians 13, that if I do anything and I don't do it out of love, it's going to profit me nothing, and I'm going to be nothing. So I don't really care how good the praise and worship is, I don't care how big your building is, I don't care how wonderful the ministry is or not. I've got to ask this question. God, did you want me to go there? And if He says He asked me to go somewhere or to do something, even to come to this group, or to come to Abu Dhabi, if He tells me to do that, then I have an opportunity to express love. I wouldn't have that if He didn't command me to come. I didn't decide to come to Abu Dhabi. God told me to come. And Pastor Shino invited me, I prayed, the Lord said, come to Abu Dhabi. But Pastor Shino might say, well, I'm busy, I've got other things to do. I'm sorry that's not available that day, but I could be home with my wife. I could have gone home on Monday or Tuesday. You know, I could have been with my wife the last 3 days. I have 4 children. They miss me terribly, and I miss them. But the only reason I'm here is because I love God more than I love my family. Do you understand? Which is a quality of a true disciple. Now, this group in your life, so one of the things is, you're getting to...
I'm going to go to the hospital. Thank you. Gracias. ഇഷ്ടമാണ് പത്തും നൂറും വർഷവും നിങ്ങൾക്ക് വന്നിട്ട് തീരുന്ന കാര്യമില്ല. മറ്റേ പറയുന്നത് വരുന്നത് നാശമായി വന്നവനാണെങ്കിലും ശ്രദ്ധയ്ക്ക് മൂല്യം ദൈവത്തിൽ വന്നവനാണെങ്കിലും ഉള്ള
അമ്മയെ വിശുദ്ധ കാര്യങ്ങളിൽ നിന്ന് എന്നെ അമ്മയാവുന്ന രീതിയിലാണ് കൊണ്ടുപോകുന്നത്. ഞങ്ങളുടെ
നമ്മുടെ വന്ന് പറയുന്നു ജീവനോട് മരിച്ചു എത്രവരും മരിച്ചവരോ മരിച്ചവരോ ഒന്നും അറിയുന്നില്ല. എന്തെങ്കിലും അറിയിക്കാം, എന്തെങ്കിലും കൊണ്ട് കൊടുക്കാമെന്ന് നീ വിചാരിച്ചാൽ അറിയുന്നില്ല. മരിച്ചവരോ ഒന്നും അറിയുന്നില്ല.
ഇത് സമൂഹമാണെന്ന പരിപാടിയല്ല, ഇത് സമയം നാളെ കൊണ്ടുള്ള പരിപാടിയല്ല, അത് ಯಾವ ಮಸ್ತ
ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നത്. ഉത്തരവാദിത്തങ്ങൾ നാലാമത്തിലേക്ക് വരുമ്പോൾ 22-23 മന്ത്രിസഭത്തിലേക്ക് വരുമ്പോൾ സർവ്വപോലെ വിഭവസമൃദ്ധമായ ഒരു മേശ കൂടെ ഒന്നിനും കുറവില്ല എന്ന് കണ്ടാവുന്ന എല്ലാവരും വായിച്ചു കേട്ടോ ശലോമോന് എന്തെങ്കിലും കുറവുള്ളതായിട്ട് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഫീൽ ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ടോ? നമുക്കൊന്നും ഫീൽ ചെയ്യില്ല, പക്ഷെ കർത്താവിന് സർവമഹത്വത്തെ ഒരു കൈയിലും ഈ പുലിക്കരിയെ ഒരു കൈയിലും പിടിച്ചുകൊണ്ട് കർത്താവ് യേശുവല്ല എന്നോടും നിന്നോടും അനുഗ്രഹിച്ചു പറയുന്നു. അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഈ പുല്ലി നോക്കിയോളം ഈ ശലോമോൻ ചറങ്ങിയിരുന്നില്ല.
ഞാനിവിടെ പുതുപോകുന്ന നീ പഠിപ്പിച്ചു നീ അന്നേ കൊണ്ടുപോയി ரொம்ப அவளை அழைச்சு விதிக்க முடியுமா? முடியா?